Hi, this is good to see Singh, and you're watching My Thick Accent Podcast. So in the vast canvas of a new country, immigrants paint their stories with hues of resilience, determination, and adaptability. Our guest today, a remarkable individual and the inaugural guest for season two of our podcast, epitomizes this immigrant spirit. Her journey to Canada was an odyssey of courage and tenacity, leaving behind the familiar to embrace the unknown. Arriving in a land where the cold winds of change blew with intensity, she exhibited a remarkable openness to embrace any job, regardless of her background. These roles were not seen as detours, instead as stepping stones in this new land she now called home, Canada. The determination to thrive propelled her forward, overcoming challenges with grace and grit. However, like many immigrants, she faced a common struggle. The richness of her international experience was sometimes dismissed, her potential obscured by the myopic lens of Canadian experience. Undeterred, she embraced this challenge, not just for herself, but for all who walked a similar path. In her journey to a leadership position, she actively advocates for putting new hires in the places where their talents truly belong. Join us as we delve into her life story, uncovering how her journey has unfolded, her inspiring perspective on success and adversity, and the wisdom she brings to the table in her professional role. Please welcome Vrinda.
I don't know what to say. I'm in awe. First off, Gurasis, thank you so much for allowing me to start your season two. Definitely super honored to be here. That's a lot of things that you said in the last 30 seconds, and I'm not sure if I step into those shoes and I can live up to that, your expectations in the next 60 minutes, but I will definitely try my best. And I'm completely humbled to hear everything that you've said. So thank you for the fantabulous introduction, if you will.
Absolutely, Vrinda. And I think you will definitely share everything that you have achieved so far. And I have no doubts that this is going to be an amazing conversation the listeners are going to love. So in my season two, I am deciding to turn up the fun factor a little bit, because Why not? We all love fun. So I'm going to start by asking you a few fun questions about all you right. And about yourself. Okay. So first is, what's your go-to breakfast?
Ooh, eggs. Okay. I need my proteins. Eggs, for sure. Eggs and bread, I would say, yeah.
Okay. And share a favorite song or a dialogue or a movie and tell us why it's significant to you.
I would say Three Idiots, Hindi movie. It is significant to me because not just me, I think a lot of people, if you ask. Yeah. I think it challenges the status quo of education in India. Absolutely. And I think it was one of its kind back in 2016, I believe, when it came out. Mm-hmm. A lot of us learned a lot. And the movie actually spoke a lot about what we've all been thinking about the education system, right? Like, it's a status quo. Everybody, you know, do things like that. You have to become an engineer, you have to become a doctor, you have to follow a path. And I think the main character of their role kind of challenged that and still did really, really well for themselves. And again, goes back to another podcast that you recently had, Challenge the Status Quo, and you and I talked about it, right? And yeah. It works. It really does. Absolutely. So I think it was an eye-opener. I think it'll always be. And I can watch that movie many, many times, actually. That one. And then I have another favorite, actually. It's Zindagi Na Milegi Dobara.
Absolutely.
Yeah. It's a fun movie. It's, you know, it teaches you how to have fun. It teaches you to, you know, kind of take a step back and enjoy life to the fullest with whatever little resources you have. You know, you can still have fun. So I think those two stand out to me when you ask that question. You caught me off guard, but I think those two come to my mind right away. But yeah.
Absolutely. I think I also love these both. And the dialogue from The Idiots, you know, passion ke piche bhago, success chak maar ke piche aayegi. I love this dialogue.
I know.
This explains everything, what you really have to, what you should do in your life. Yeah. Yeah. And even that narration of Farhan Akhtar's voice of that poem, you know, Zinda Ho Tum, that narration is also beautiful.
I think it it speaks volume of what we all want to speak sometime, right? It speaks
Absolutely.
the heart of the common man or common woman in growing up in India and going through the status quo. Nothing against it. I think we've all done
Of
really,
course.
really well for whatever we've, you know, however we've been born and bred. But I think it's a nice balance between keeping up your culture, keeping up your, you know, parents, their dreams for you, but being able to respect that and at the same time live your own life in your own terms. I think it's a really nice, sweet balance, I think, that we all can represent and we carry, I think.
Wow, yeah, I think you have articulated it so perfectly. Loved it.
Oh, thank you.
So my next question is, if you had to teach one phrase in your native language, what would it be and what does it mean?
I would say, you know, coming from Delhi and just the normal way of greeting, like jaise hum haath jod ke greet karte hain. So I think just explaining that to somebody, I think it goes a long way. And, you know, sometimes I do it as well when I'm really humbled and grateful for something. Even when I'm talking to people, it just comes to me naturally. So I just fold my hands and I just say thank you so much. And I think it kind of, it's infectious. I've seen the other person who's not, who's, you know, English speaking or doesn't understand what this is, they automatically do that. For some reason, it's just so humbling. I think it comes across as very humbling. So just folding your hands and truly, you know, showing your gratitude explicitly, I think that's something that I would like people to, you know, kind of acknowledge and take away.
Yeah, amazing. So lastly, if you could teleport back to a particular place from your home country for a day, where would it be and what would you do?
Delhi. It just, you know, it will be Delhi. And where will I go? What will I do? I think if I have to be teleported to a place, I would say have golgappas in the streets of maybe Srinagar or Grolbagh. Just the street food, enjoy that. And just the hustle bustle, you know, very Desi at heart, very Delight at heart, you can call it. That's what I would do. That's what comes to my mind right away. Enjoy shopping and do that kind of stuff and meet my friends, live that life again.
Okay, great. So speaking of that, let's talk a little bit more about your time you spent in Delhi. Tell us a little bit about your growing years and also the high school.
Absolutely. So my parents migrated from South India. So my maiden name was Vrinda Krishnan before I got married. But my parents lived in Delhi for a long, long time before we were born. So I think they migrated in 60s, 70s, I believe. And then me and my sister, we were both born in Delhi. And yeah, the upbringing was very simple, middle class family. I would say my mom was a central government employee. My dad worked for the Australian High Commission. Before that, he worked for the American Embassy. So we lived in Arkipuram, which is more like a central government employee's, you know, homes that you live in, that kind of an area. Went to a convent, which, you know, was nice of our parents to have, you know, been able to educate us in a nice, very brilliant at that point in time, I would say, education system. We had, that was run by nuns, and, you know, it was it was quite a lot of discipline and inculcation of, you know, a lot of Catholic values, if you will, right? Going to the chapel every day and just a different lifestyle from what you would have got when you were being born and bred in a South Indian family in north of India with the, you know, your South Indian culture, but then you're also trying to mingle with your North Indian friends. And then you go to school, then you're trying to inculcate, you know, a different form of discipline altogether. But I think all in all, I think from very young stages of my life, we've been so adaptable to so many different, you know, styles of living in one day, like get up in the morning, you know, you're getting ready for school and then your mom, like you got a lunchbox, you make a lunch, she'll make you a lunchbox and that would usually be parathas or something like that because all of the central government employees pretty much function the same way. I believe like all of the kids used to get the same thing. So we'll take that, go to school, right when you enter your school, you go to the chapel, you kneel down, you do your name of the father and all of that. You do your prayers, finish school, you know, then hang out with your friends who are Punjabis. So, you know, go to their house, their grandparents can't speak Hindi, so they're speaking in Punjabi with you. And then you kind of understand Punjabi, learn Punjabi as well. at the same time. It was fun. And then come back home, then change again into your culture that you're being bred in, which is your South Indian culture, what have you. So it's been kind of inculcated in people, not just me, a lot of people who whose parents have migrated, who live in a different state in India. We talk about immigration, we talk about that change. I think a lot of us have gone through that change already in our own home
In
countries, and if
countries,
we can
yeah.
resonate with that, and it's like childhood has, I have no complaints. We've like I said, great schooling. We've whatever we are today, obviously, is because of the basics that we learned in school and in high school and what have you. Lots of, as you know, I do feel like, as a kid migrating, we feel like, there's racism, there's, accent issues and what have you. But I think we all face that, especially coming from a South Indian background, living in the north of India. Our Hindi was very strong because we learned Hindi in Delhi, right? But I still believe that, in those days, in the 80s and the 90s, we still had that little bit of a difference between, North Indian, South Indian, which is not there anymore. I feel, with the global movement and people living all around the globe now, also in India, there's a lot of movement. Things have changed. They've come a long way, but not at that time. We used to, kind of have that Madrasi kind of, labeling and all that. So I've personally gone through all that. The fact that my teachers always thought I couldn't do a great job, but when I was in grade 12, I did excel in I took commerce, by the way, my 11th and 12th. I came first in my whole entire school in commerce. So I did kind of go to that extent where I was like, I had to prove something to some people, and I'm going to do that. So I did take it really to my heart, all of the bullying and all of the, whatever. But I think it's important to also take it in the right stride, right? Like, yes, it was at the time you feel like, oh my God, it was stressful at the time. I think when you're a teenager and, people are trying to label you and stuff like that. But I think what comes out of it is what you make of it, right? Like, that's important. But at the time, you don't know that. You just react the way you do. Now I know that because I'm mature. I look back, I think how I reacted. But I think that was it, my upbringing. But it was good. No complaints. Like I said, very, it's important to think about it positively, because whatever you take out of it, you learn, you put into practice, and then you become a better person, right? So thank you to all of those teachers. Thank you to all of those friends of mine, my neighbors, my friends, my school buddies, who did what they did for, for giving me the opportunity to learn and grow from that. Yeah, and then that was history. And then I went to Delhi University to do my graduation in commerce. My dad was working for the Australian High Commission, so he could, get me a job with the Australian High Commission. And back then it was huge.
You worked there for 4 years, I believe, right?
Yes, I did. I did, and it was huge at the time. You're so young, you're just out of your college, and you get a job which pays you so well. Like, what more can you ask for, right? So did that, and it was fun. I still love my colleagues. We're still all in touch. That actually shaped that. Those 4 years were very crucial for my career growth. I would say that actually changed a lot of things within me unknowingly at the time. Again, you're very young. What do you know when you're? I feel like the 20s, I'm, probably aging myself, which is perfectly fine. But I think the 20s that we went through is very different to the 20s that this generation is going through. And I can say that because I have a 21-year-old, and I can see that the level of maturity, the clarity that they have about what they want to do in future, they're very clear. And I love seeing that. And I think when we were in our 20s, we learned things unknowingly. At least I can speak for myself. Like, I learned it, but I wasn't recognizing the fact of what I'm learning at that point in time. It was all, there's a lot to unpack. Like I said, now I can say there's a lot to unpack, because those were my transitioning periods. So those first job, fantastic exposure, working, living in Delhi, working with Australian expats, learning from them, growing, just the way, how you put yourself forward in a professional environment. And then, during all this time, I got married, and and then had my son right away. So did all of that. And I lost my mother, actually, when I was when I just finished my graduation. So that was definitely a blow. But nevertheless, life goes on. And I know my mom has been watching me from up above. And 100%, anything I am today is because she has been there as the pillar of strength from then to now. And life goes on. And my husband decided to do his master's from Leeds Business School.
Mm-hmm.
And then we moved on to the next phase of our life, if you will, as new immigrants into England.
So before we talk about that, I want to just go back to your parenting style once again. You talked about that a couple of times, and since you are a mother yourself, so what is something from your parents' upbringing style that you are incorporating into yours, or what is something different that you are doing? And I also want to highlight this one thing you talked about, you being not the brightest student, right? Or a lot of focus was on like, what kind of grades are you getting and everything. And but now norms a little bit have changed. It's not the same anymore. It's more about the person instilling those values and principles in people rather than just focusing on marks and everything. So keeping all that in mind, tell us like about your parenting style.
For sure. It's a great question, Gurasis. I think certain things that we as parents have inculcated in Samir would be, the gratitude, the culture. We speak to him in Hindi.
Okay.
He went to England when he was very young, regardless whether he calls me at work or he's in front of me. Both me and my husband, we speak to him in Hindi. He responds back in English, which is fine, but we know that ever since he was born, he's always heard Hindi. He can survive. He can speak Hindi very comfortably. He does. He shies away, but we've seen him speak Hindi very comfortably. So we know he can.
Okay.
So that's one thing that we wanted to, regardless of where we live, language is very important. Secondly, just the gratitude and the respect for, people. That's it. Regardless of what their age is, I think it's important to have that respect for anybody. And that I think we, we've inculcated in him, and he respects his surroundings. He respects his, people that he speaks with. And, he's kind of got that. I feel those are very important, non-negotiable things for us as parents. Things that we are mindful of, that we don't want to repeat, that we felt like, that wasn't the way we wanted to be. I don't know, like at that time we didn't, but I think just with the generational gap, I would say, it's very important to not enforce what you want to become to make your kids do that.
Yeah.
I think it's very important. Let them be. Do what you want to do. I think trust is very important. It goes a long way. I think putting the trust in your kids. Not that our parents didn't have. That's another thing we got from our parents, both my husband and I. Our parents trusted us so much. They just trusted every decision that we made. And I think that is something that we are paying forward, or we got from our parents, and we continue to do that with our parenting, style as well. And grades and all of that, I think it's just not us as parents, it's just all of this generation of parents who are, like us, who have young kids or teenager kids or kids who are in their 20s. It is almost irrelevant, at least outside of India. In India, I do have, my sister-in-law still there. We have very close relative who still have that kind of, the environment is still, it's changing. It's come a long way, but I think it's hard to make that leap of change with the education system altogether. But I think just wherever you are, I think grades don't matter. I think they're recognizing the fact of what your child likes to do. I think that's important as a parent. And I think we try our best. I don't know if we are 100% there. I don't know that. It's hard for me to say, but I think at least both my husband and I, we have, whenever we talk, we make sure that we recognize what the child likes to do.
Yeah.
And we encourage them to do that and support them and be there for them to say, you want to do this? No problem. Go for it. But it's also important as a parent to show them the right path, right? Like we can't, it's a fine balance. Like we don't have a manual for parenting, right? So it's every parent is different. You do your best given the circumstances, given what you have in your hand. It's also important to show them the path. It's one thing to like something, but it's also another thing to make sure that you're smart about what you like. At the end of the day, the outcome has to be you making money for yourself. right? So you have to be smart enough to think about that, and being educated, being, you know, living in this country for, or living abroad for so long, or just having that exposure to education and that path, the career path, I think it's definitely beneficial. And I think we would not be doing justice by not sharing our knowledge with them in a way that, not, like I said, not enforcing it or not making them do something, but at the same time, having that open conversation. Hey, have you looked into this? Hey, do you think you can do this? Or do you, how about this? Do you like this? You know, asking those open-ended questions. I think it's, we're a little bit more mindful. I think this generation of parents, I've seen a lot of other friends of mine who have kids of the same age. I think we're all, you know, we relate to parenting quite a lot, right? We definitely do. So, and also being first immigrant parents, it's hard.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, at least I have also seen that change happening within my vicinity, at least my sisters, I would say, even my bhabis and sister and brother-in-laws, and everybody has really integrated that thing in their children that marks are not everything. You know, just exactly what you said. I have seen that change happening, and I'm sure even the next generation is going to be even better than that. they're going to do the make changes for sure. But tell us, what was your dream career growing up?
Growing up, I wanted to become a lawyer. Then my mom wanted me to do that. That I, you know, I don't know, I could have tried giving it a shot probably, but that was my dream career.
So let's just pivot towards your move to England. Tell us what influenced the decision to move.
So my husband decided he wanted to do his master's, and he wanted to do his master's abroad, MBA. And when we were looking for options, I think Leeds Business School actually stood out at the time. So we packed our bags. We said, okay, here we go. Let's go. And we did that. And we landed in London. And then we moved to, obviously, we went to Leeds from there on. And we started, our little stint in England from there.
Yeah. And you have mentioned that it was your first recognition of the thick accent there. Talk a little bit about that experience.
Yes, absolutely. So, you know, when, like I said, when you're, the exposure is so important because you learn so much, and here it started, right? Because English was, obviously English is not our first language, and we recognize that, right? English is something that we've learned. And thankfully, like I said, growing up, we went to really good schools. So, you know, we've always spoken English, which was grammatically correct. There was no issues with that. But remember, we've also, regardless of which school you go to, the way you're taught English, this certain words, the way you pronounce them, absolutely different to how either it should be pronounced, if you want to call it in an English way, or in a way that people would understand when you articulate, right? So when we first moved to England, I mean, there was no issues in us talking in English, but I think it was also almost, I would say, how many years ago was it? 2006, so almost like 15, 17 years ago, things were different. People were not so welcoming, and people had the audacity to actually tell you on your face, what are you talking about? Or, you know, and stuff like that. So there were certain, there were many, many instances where, I went out to work. My husband was a student, so I was working full time. Lots of challenges, right? We had a little 3-year-old with us at the time. And, lots of things were going on. But when it came to, you know, finding work, we'll go out, I'll go out for an interview, for example, and then they'll say, oh, your English is really, how come you speak really good English? I'm surprised that people still say that, right? 17 years ago, people said that was already quite shocking, because they were so oblivious of where India was and how education was so important in India. And people still say that. I've heard that in some of your podcasts, and I've gone through it myself as well. Living in Canada for 10 years. But at that time, that was just not it. Some people would, you know, when I've spoken to some people in England, they would actually make you feel they don't understand what you're talking about.
Like intentionally.
They'd say, okay, say that again, repeat that word. And that, you know, that kind of was almost, I would say, a turning point for me, because I took it as a challenge. And I would say, you know, it was almost like trying to become perfect at pronouncing certain words that we were taught to pronounce differently. So I think that's when I recognized my thick accent. not to change your accent or anything. I think it's just, you don't have to change yourself to fit in. I'm a big believer of
Absolutely,
that.
yeah, me too.
But at the same time, I also feel like you have to work on yourself to an extent that you're able to articulate yourself in a manner that you want to come across. That's important, because you might be trying to say something which people understand completely differently because of the words that you choose to use in that sentence. And that was the recognition that I thought about, or I taught myself to think, okay, this is what I want to say. I'm thinking, it comes to us naturally. We think in Hindi and then we translate. Not anymore. I've seen a lot of people, all of this generation, they're smart. I think also the way people are taught English is different now, I guess. But at the time, you think in Hindi then you just translate that. And that doesn't come across as to what you were trying to say. Where I think for myself, that's where I was kind of, it was a point where I was like, okay, I need to switch this. What am I going to do? So that was, that was my thick accent recognition, phase, if you will. And then just educate, like I took that upon myself to learn and pronounce and spend time pronouncing it myself, certain words that I thought I wasn't pronouncing correctly. I think it only benefited me. I didn't take it in a way, I did feel bad, like everybody does, right? It throws you out. It's like, it throws your confidence out of the window. I can tell you that much. As much as you gather yourself, you're already new to a country, and you can say whatever you want. And I'm a big believer of the fact that they didn't call me to London. I made this way. They didn't call me to Leeds, right? Like, they didn't tell me, come, we need you, right? I made that decision. We made that decision. It's my responsibility to make myself comfortable to a point that I don't blame anybody else, right? It's easy to say, oh my God, these people are racist. They will be racist. They don't want you there. Right. Yeah. Like, it's, let them be the way that doesn't mean that they're doing the right thing or you're doing the wrong thing or you're doing the right thing. It's not about the blame game here. But I think, like I said, the racism or the bullying or the Madrasi, North Indian, all of that's already there everywhere in the world.
Yeah.
Why are we so hurt when we come abroad and, people actually teach you how to speak, or not teach you, they put you in your place, tell you that you don't speak our language.
Yeah.
And so I don't know. I took it in that way, and I think it's just put me at a better position from the way I speak, the way I think, and I don't think there's anything wrong with that.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think everything that you have said is literally the essence of the podcast. That's actually what podcast is all about. And you all said it very correctly, that in no way, we are pointing fingers that you did this to me, you did that to me through my podcast. I'm just trying to tell people that sometimes all we need is a little bit of acknowledgement, to just be a little bit of heard. Because, for example, in Canada, we are here to stay. We are not going back anywhere. In fact, we are even bringing our relatives here now. So we are here to stay. And I also always use this one analogy. I recently spoke in Toronto somewhere at an event, and I use the analogy of, imagine you walking into a room and somebody gets and tell me, Gurusis, I don't like your clothes, go change it. Will you ever go and change it? No, you will not. So why is that when it comes to our accents, all just want to change it, just because somebody doesn't understand it, somebody doesn't like it? And then I also said, how, yes, my understanding of fashion might have evolved in the past 5-6 years. I may be able to buy some articles which I couldn't buy back in India, maybe. But doesn't mean I'll just stop wearing the way I'm wearing my clothes, or I stop wearing the way the turban I'm wearing, right? Similarly, it happens with the pronunciation. Since childhood, we are taught to say certain things in a certain way. We are asked to say your consonants properly, say your vowels properly, A, E, I, O, we all have done that. But when you come here, you see that rolling of R's is different. Work becomes work, birth becomes birth, turban becomes turban, gurasis become gurasis or gurasis, or even jurasis at times, So this is all part of it, right? Absolutely.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
I think it's high time that, and I don't blame them, because that's how they were taught to pronounce certain things, all these people. And I think it's high time that we guys should also just own it, and why to be embarrassed by it? Just own it however you are. Yeah.
100%. And I totally endorse everything that you're saying. And I think that your uniqueness, your imperfections make you what you are. And I think
100%,
everybody should be proud and wear that very proudly on your sleeve. And, we learn, we grow. And I think that's about it, right? Like, that's why we share what we learn. So other people can either, listen to it, because it's nice to hear other people's story, not for anything, I think just to relate. You feel like I'm not alone in this.
Absolutely.
With all your podcasts that we've seen, there's a unique line of
integrity.
Yeah, integrity and similarity thread between all of the people who come to your podcast and speak about immigration, regardless of where they come from, whether they come from, Colombia. I know you interviewed somebody from Colombia, a journalist, or whether they come from Nigeria, whether they come from India, Pakistan, or wherever, right? Like,
Absolutely.
There's a unique thread of similarity, which is just sharing your story, sharing the authentic story, where you come from, what you learned. And that's just wonderful.
Absolutely. So what kind of job were you doing in England when you were there?
So when I was in England, we were in Leeds. So when I was in Leeds, I worked for a legal company. It was a massive legal firm, and I worked there as a legal assistant. Again, it was fantastic. It was all related to banking again. So what we really did was people buying properties. We used to do the closing of those properties. So liaison between the bank and the realtor, or two different banks, taking the mortgage from one bank, paying off the other bank, refinancing and stuff like that. So very interesting stuff. Mm-hmm. Learned a lot there from a point of view of systems, very new technology. I think there were about 1,500, 2,000 employees in that organization. And then I worked for an architect firm. Mm-hmm. It was a small firm called the Lorock Architects, so I took care of all of their admin stuff. Again, learned a lot there as well from point of view of, just presenting yourself, administrative work, how different it is, how admin stuff is done. And those jobs were just to keep us afloat, to be honest, in Leeds, because my husband was a full-time student. We had to balance our little one with, kind of dropping, picking. But we really had a good set of friends there with the university. There's a lot of people who came from Delhi who were really close-knit. So it was like a family. So we had a good time there. And then we moved to London after my husband finished his graduation. In London, I could go back, start working for the South African High Commission, because that's what I left when I left Delhi.
Yeah.
So it was just wonderful to just go in, and they welcomed me with the open arms. It was just the best place you can dream of working. I think it was like a dream come true. And just very, very fast life London was, because we were living in the outskirts, so we had to take the train. It was a bit of a whirlwind, if you will, because I had to bring Samir to downtown Toronto, drop him in school, take another tube, go back to work, and then finish work, run, go get him. Because every minute, they charge you by a minute for childcare, like they do in Canada. I think there's no difference there, but it was so expensive. You just had to, it was just like a rat's race. And then poor Samir used to be like a little boy, right? 4 or 5 years old at the time. And then we used to sit on the train. And some very fond memories of those times. And we used to play quiz. I used to do a quiz for him every day to keep him, on the train, just to keep him engaged, if you will. And I used to ask him capital cities of different countries across the globe. And it used to be so fun. Everybody sitting around us, they used to start participating. And it was nice. I still remember that. And Samir remembers that vividly, too. Every time we talk about our time in London, it used to be an hour ride on the train. So, and we didn't have... at the time, iPhone was just very new. We had the Blackberries at the time. So it wasn't like we could watch a video or something on the phone. Like kids would normally do that, iPads and stuff. It was just evolving, if you will, right? So it was still, how creative can you be as a mom to keep your child engaged rather than handing them an iPad or a, iPhone. So it was fun. And then that's it.
So moving on, let's just pivot towards talking about the transition to Canada. What was the process for you like, and how long did it take you?
So, it was just the process was we wanted to go into a better economy. At the time when we came here, the economy was booming in Canada. So that was one of the reasons. So we decided to move. And when we decided to move, We wanted to obviously make that decision really quickly because we weren't in our 20s anymore when we were deciding to move. So it wasn't like we had another 10 years to our credit that we can make life from scratch. So we decided to just get on with it and see what is the quickest move. So I started studying. So I came on a student visa and my husband got a. So that was kind of the way we decided because we knew with his MBA and stuff, he's going to shine. He definitely gets something very quickly. And the easiest way was to come in as a student. And then we just took our chance, right? Like we didn't want to wait for 3 or 4 years to get our permanent residence and land. So we ended up in Vancouver. I took a little course in management in Vancouver and in a college there. And my husband started looking for jobs. Again, welcome to Canada. Piece we came he was on a work permit and we very quickly realized that if you're on a work permit, it was an open work permit, it wasn't something that was welcome in this country. They were looking for landed immigrants, which was a bit of a surprise for us. I mean, he could work with any company for a period of 3 years, but he interviewed and with some really great companies. They loved him, they wanted to hire him, but then they were like, okay, we have a candidate who's permanent resident, so we'll prefer him to you because we don't know what's going to happen. But you think something and something else happens. So we tried, we really wanted to live in Vancouver because Toronto or BC, right? That's where you go. So it was a nice place. We wanted to live there, but life had different plans for us. So he went for a few interviews. We almost got to a point where it was desperation, right? You have a child, and we need to get on with it very quickly. So he pretty much started applying for jobs everywhere across Canada. He was like, okay, let me see what I can get. So he got this job. He ended up with this job in Saskatchewan in Weyburn with Sastel, which is the only crown company in Canada, which is a telecom company. He was offered a good good position, and he was like, okay, I'll take it. Like we're gonna take it regardless, right? They agreed to sponsor as well because it was a crown company. Our whole immigration was going to get on fast track.
Easier.
So he said, I'm taking it. So he left, he came here, and then they supported us. They said, we're going to apply for your work permit through Sastel, and then we'll do the permanent residence stuff like that. So then that's it. That was our beginning of our life in Saskatchewan.
Canadian journey. So tell us about your first day, initial thoughts or emotions when you landed in Canada.
It was excitement when we first came. It was positivity. It was looking forward to a new life for Samir, for us. What are we going to do in this country? It was a little bit of anxiousness too. I think that just comes with the
The unknown.
the ambiguity of what you're going to end up doing and how long is it going to take you to get to the citizenship phase, right? Because we've already gone through it once in England. We had to go through it again here, obviously by choice. Like I said, I mean, I would hate to blame anybody or sound like somebody made me do it. It was our doing. We decided to, but that also came with a lot of stress. It's different, like I said, if we were in our 20s and we came here to study and we had the whole life and there were no dependents, we could do whatever we want, we could go wherever we want. I think we also were mindful of moving our son from place to place to place, which was also a big kind of decision for us to keep in mind as we do that. But kids are very resilient.
So I want to talk a little bit more about your time in Weyburn, Saskatchewan. And I remember you were telling me that when you moved to Canada, it was your second immigration. And you have said that you were quite polished and ready to mingle, so to say. So tell us like about your time you spent there. And then obviously you were from HR background, but you were not working in that, and you were ready to take on any job. And I still can't forget you told me that you said that I was ready to do anything, regardless of my background. And this mindset is amazing to have, especially when you are new to the country. Tell us how that mindset has helped you in your Canadian journey in the initial years.
You put it so well, Gurasis, I have to admit. Yes, so when we moved to Weyburn, Saskatchewan, obviously a couple of things, right? I want to continue. I really did want to continue my studies, for sure. I wanted to take that leap. But that being said, a lot of constraints, right? We wanted to get into the job market. At least one person was good. Like my husband had a good job. We had, financially, money was flowing in. That was taken care of. But then obviously I wanted to get into the workforce as quickly as I could as well. So I went around applying. Weyburn is a very small place. For our listeners who don't know where Weyburn is, if you Google it, it's a very small place outside of Regina, the capital of Saskatchewan. It's about an hour and 15 minutes drive south of Regina. The total population of Weyburn is about 10,000, give or take. So that's how many people live there. And it's predominantly a farming community. So the people who live there's a lot of immigration happening now, of course, due to, the PR and the easy ways of getting your permanent residency and stuff like that. But you still, it's a very transient immigrant population, if you will, right? Like people come there, get their PR, citizenship, move to BC or, Calgary or Edmonton, or come here to GTA. To answer your question, yes, I was ready to do whatever I could because it's very important to recognize where you are and know your audience, I feel. I'm in a place where I'm not going to get a job which is going to be is going to be relatable to my experience very clearly, or I'm not going to get a job to become a GM in any company where people don't even know me. They're not going to take a bet on me. They have no idea who I am. I just came here. By face value, nobody's gonna take a bet on you to, give you that position. So what can I do differently was my thought. I just wanted to get into the workforce just to understand the culture, work culture of Canada. That was my intention. My intention was nothing else. So I went around, I dropped my resume at Walmart, dropped my resume at Superstore, mom pop shop, whatever, all the banks, everywhere. Walmart called me. And I didn't really apply for a position. It was such a small place that you just go and drop your resume and somebody will call you. There's no technology or there's no online applications and stuff. You do that at a later stage. So I got a call and then I spoke to this wonderful lady. She's the assistant manager and she spoke with me and she said, after like a 20-minute conversation, she said, "Why don't you come see me next week and let's just do an interview." I said, "Absolutely." So I went there for an interview. We had more like a formal interview. She asked me about my background and all of that. And then right after the interview, she said, "You know what, Vrinda, I don't think I will be able to give you a cashier's job." And you know what? I wasn't, it was okay. I was like, okay, but I would like some solid feedback. Why is that? So I can, kind of improve for the next time. And she said, "No, because you're overqualified. You have a lot of experience. Would you like to take up a role as an assistant manager?" And I said, "Absolutely, I will. Absolutely." So that was like the frontline customer service. If you go into Walmart, you see all of the tellers, all of the cashiers, and the front desk, right? The customer service desk. So the person who leads that team is called the customer experience manager, or what have you, right? So I took on that. I had about 35, 40 people reporting into me, and it was very, very challenging. I was just really, really grateful and thankful that I, got an opportunity to get into the workforce just to understand, how people work there, right? Like, what is the thought process around? Again, it was a small place, like I said, predominantly, a lot of local people, if you will, right? Like farming community or people who've lived there for their lives. It was just a different environment. Also, again, there was a little bit of what do you call it? People didn't, it was hard for them to accept that I was leading their team, right? They've been there for 20, 25 years. They almost revolted, but not revolted. You know what I mean? They won't show up for their shifts because I put them in a certain shift. Because they've worked there for 15 years or 20 years, they don't want to listen. And stuff like that. So I went through that piece, lots of learning experience there as well. I think I had the courage to really stand up for myself and in certain situations actually say to them on their face, like, "Nobody stopped you from taking this role.
Why
Be my
me?
guest. You've been here 20 years, more than happy to be led by you. You do this role. Why did they give it to me? Like, think about it. It's easy to just stand up and say, I don't want to listen to this person. So I think those were learning experiences and also experience to stand up for yourself and say, hey, I'm not going to take BS. Right. So it was a good experience. But then it got to a point where over the weekends, I was working constantly, right? I was just, it was so intriguing. And I was having fun in that job. It was so fast paced that I was almost losing track of my personal life. Like my son was growing up at the time, and I wanted to spend time with him. My husband had the weekends off. And because of this fast paced, job, I was working my weekends. And even weekdays, when I got time off, I used to go work there because it's a small place, right? Everybody knows everybody. So I'll just go spend a couple of hours there. And that wasn't good for my personal life. So that's when I started actively looking for, 9 to 5, Monday to Friday jobs, just to find a work-life balance. And I applied to the banks quite a few times, but never had a call from any of the banks. Of course, why would they, right? I don't bring a banking background. But then there was this open house that happened in CIBC in Weyburn.
So, you talked about how people were a little shocked to see you like a different person leading the teams. But that wasn't the only time you were questioned, like, oh, you are the manager here. Because the same you had, similar experience you had within the CIB in the initially as well, where obviously you said you went to an open house, you took the job as an entry-level position, you were promoted to a senior person, and then eventually you became the branch manager. And that's where also you have heard this question, oh, so you are the branch manager here. And that's solely because they haven't seen a brown person leading a branch ever before you. So talk a little bit about that experience.
Yeah, people have been really welcoming, I would say, for the most part. But I think you always find people who question the status quo. And there's nothing wrong with that. The only thing I would say is there's nothing wrong in asking the question. The way you ask it is what makes all the difference, right? So the way that question was asked to me was, as like, they added a now with it. So you are the branch manager now, question mark. So that kind of, took me to a different tangent there. And I just politely asked them, I had a smile on my face. Let's keep it professional. It's not personal. I just, asked them to explain, what do you mean by that? Can you tell me more? So I can answer your question. What do you mean by that? Right. Yeah. And then, they just had questions around, where did you come from? What is your education and stuff? And the only thing I said to them was, you're asking me questions that are too personal to me. And I don't think this is a platform for me to, dive into it. I'll be more than happy to share anything professionally related that you want to know about your banking or what have you, but anything personal, I don't think I'm comfortable in sharing that with you. But thank you, I appreciate your question, and I'm hoping that you can continue to have your trust in me and my team. And I left it at that. I think it's important to be professional, but
absolutely,
it is also an eye-opener for a lot of people to know that the world is moving in a different way. This is not the first and this is not the last. You'll see a
100%.
Lot of people like me moving forward who are, there to help you to be a part of the community and to stay, right?
Yeah.
Like you said.
Yeah. And I think like you said that it was a small place and you were the first person to kind of, they came across, and I'm sure things have changed now. And many people will be inspired by your journey here listening to you that, okay, maybe Saskatchewan and Weyburn is the place to go to and to start your journey. And I remember you also telling me that that place has less competition and you also have a higher standard of living as well. And that's how even helped you to grow personally as well in that place. So tell us a little bit about the city. Like, how's the city like in general?
Honestly, in my true words, it's a sleepy little town. Regina is definitely growing. It's much better. But the one good thing is because everybody knows everybody, once you've lived there, like in 2-3 years time, when, we started knowing people from different backgrounds, we had no family there, right? So we had to build our social circle from scratch.
Absolutely.
There's a lot of immigrant population as well. But I think the most important thing is to come out of your comfort zone. That's what I feel is important for you to be comfortable yourself. So you need to come out of your comfort zone, learn to do things that you haven't done in so long. So I learned curling as part of the CIBC team. we used to put a team together to curl in the local curling tournament. I hadn't even heard of curling before, but then I learned how to curl, and I feel very proud of, you know, being able to represent our team, being able to be a part of that team, curling with that team, at least for 3 years in a row. So that's something new that I learned. And then we learned skiing when we were there. We made, you know, different friends, and I've always appreciated being a part of a group of people that doesn't look like me. I think that's important to grow, like come out of your comfort zone, be comfortable with the uncomfortable. A lot of people talk about that, and that literally is walking the talk, right? You need to be able to do that very comfortably, and there's nothing wrong with that.
I think that is a great segue to my next segment, where I remember asking you that, what have you discovered, Vrinda, in the past 10 years? And you told me, I have discovered that confidence within me. And you said the confidence that has brought you this far with all of the chances that have happened in your life, everything that has happened in your life. Like you said, you know, you learned curling, you learned skiing, and you said you were like ready to take on anything that came your way. I remember you telling me you want to put like a barbecue, I'll go ahead and do that. You want me to start knitting, I'll go ahead and start knitting. So tell me how all that evolution happened, and what sort of like words of wisdom do you like to pass on to the listeners who might be going to the similar phase, new to the country, kind of lost, ready to mingle, but don't know where to go? What would you tell them?
You put it so well, and you make me sound like somebody.
The guru.
Yeah, no. And thank you for doing that.
Of course.
But I think there's one more thing that I also, you know, confidence, of course, I think it's important to put your best foot forward. It's also, you know, life is only 10% of what happens to you. 90% is how you deal with it.
Love
that.
That's
important.
Yeah.
And I think that the sooner people realize that, I think they would be in the right path. I mean, I'm nobody to preach. You know, I'm humbled for this opportunity to talk to you and share my experience. But this is just my perspective of looking at life. Life will present to you. And, you know, only 10% of life is what happens. The glass is half full or glass is half empty is your perception of it. And when you perceive it as half empty, then it is half empty. When you perceive it as half full, then you go a long way. One other thing that I've learned in the last 10 years, the question that you asked, and I had a chance to reflect, mm-hmm. is I used to listen to respond. Now I listen to understand. And I think when we can differentiate between that, it's very important. When people talk to you or they criticize you or they say something or they just are talking, mm-hmm. just talk to understand where they're coming from. Because mostly, I don't know about other people, but I do see when I see other people, you make some observations and you see most people are ready to respond.
Yeah.
Somebody asks something, let me respond. Let me defend myself. I think a lot of stages in your life comes where you just need to take a backseat and listen and understand where they're coming from, what they're saying before you take the step. And sometimes it's okay not to respond. It's okay for other people to talk. It's okay for you to be the listener. And I think that's one thing that I have learned personally in my journey. You know, it's okay to just, you know, be there, listen, and listen to understand. So these are the two things that I feel, you know, the glass is half full, half empty. You know, it's how you perceive life is important. And ready to do everything, anything in life. You know, everybody's journey is different. Everybody is in a different stage of life. I have seen a lot of people who are immigrants. They come in and they come in with an attitude of, this is who I was, this is how I want to be. There's nothing wrong with that.
Yep.
There's absolutely nothing wrong with that. But the only thing I would say is there has to be a reality check. Mm-hmm. When you come in with that expectation for yourself, for your career, make sure that you've done your homework so you can put yourself in that pedestal. Because when you come in with that expectation, I was a GM, I was a VP, I won't budge. I will not take anything less than that. Kudos to you. But what homework did you do to get there would be my
Absolutely.
Question.
Yeah.
If you want me as a hiring manager to hire you as whatever you came here for, maybe a GM, absolutely. But show me and tell me, why should I do that when I have somebody else who's been here for 10 years who's equally good as you? I think that USP that you bring to the table is important for people to be able to articulate, for people to be able to deliver, people to be, carry on your shoulder. Like,
yeah.
Jo dikhta hai, wahi bikta hai. simple.
Yeah,
You know, if
absolutely.
you are not able to show that, you know, if you can, for our listeners who understand English, is, you know, what you see is what gets sold, right, at the end of the day. So that's what it is. So that's I think is in a nutshell.
Absolutely. I love that line. You know, 10% of what happens to you and 90% how you react to it. This is, I think, a great word of advice for everybody, because we do have this tendency to really see all the say all the time, oh, you know, this happened to me, that happened to me. But nothing happens to you, it happens for you. You just have to see the bigger picture around it, that why it is happening, and just to see that. And also, I always say that God or higher power or whosoever the people, you know, preach to or look up to, I would say that God will never put you in places where he knows that you won't be able to handle this. He always put
Correct.
you in situations that know that you have the capacity and the audacity to really tackle this situation. So I think I learned it the hard way. Was the one, I would say, like a few years ago, would question that, why is this happening to me? Why that is happening to me? But you just forget that a lot of amazing things also happened to me. Why didn't I question it then? So I think it's important for us to see that, hey, just accept it, learn from it, find the good in every adversity that come your way. There is definitely some good in it. Of course, it's hard to analyze it in that very moment, but if you'll see it in a couple of years or later on, you'll see that I'm so glad that happened, because that has prepared me for this moment today, where I am today. I also had our common friend, a mutual friend on the podcast, Shruti, who was here, and with her I was talking about, you know, how important it is to have people on the decision-making process who will understand the pain points of new hires. And in our immigrant experience situation, understand the importance of the international experience. And I think that's where you were telling me that I want to place people where they belong, as you are in the leadership role right now. Tell us that how building that ecosystem has really accelerated people's success or accelerated the success of immigrants in your observation.
Absolutely. I think it's a very important point to recognize as immigrants, and especially for some of us who are fortunate enough to be in a position where we have the ability to help and pay forward. I'll go back to what I said. If you come with the expectation of getting a very similar job, you know, make sure that you put your best foot forward. And if I know of somebody through my connections, which would be either TRIAC, where I mentor, or a Regina Open Door Society, Saskatchewan Open Door Society, through my connections, I'm definitely making an attempt to either recommend those people to get in a job, or at least get a job interview. If it's not with me, what I tend to do is at least try to give them a platform where they can show what they're capable of. And I think that's huge. I think we should be thankful that we're all, at least we're getting that opportunity. A lot of people don't get that. If I am able to hire somebody, you know, I'd say this again, for, you know, first deserve, then desire is important. And I say that in a very, you know, unique way, because as an individual, as I know what I deserve before I desire. So I can't speak for you, or I can't speak for someone else, but I think it's a self-assessment that people have to make. It's in no shape or form trying to say, oh my God, what do you mean I don't deserve this? I don't know. You probably do, or you probably don't. Make that decision for yourself. So when you come to me for an interview, or when you go to somebody else for an interview and you want a GM role, think about it. Do you deserve it? So first deserve, then desire is my piece. And if you know that you deserve it, then you're going to put your best foot forward. You're going to be, you know, the person who's supposed to get that job, and there's no doubt that you will win it. There has been situations or examples that I'm very proud of, where I've had people who have come in with a banking background, they've done, and I've been able to connect them with, you know, my counterparts within CIBC, where they've interviewed, they've, you know, shown their best, put their best foot forward, and secured the roles in a level, in the levels that they deserve to be. They didn't have to start from scratch like I did, right? So that's what's paying it forward is. I was a very small, I would say, you know, path for their success. I take no credit to that, because I still leave it to them, right? And as should we, right? I can put in a recommendation. I can say, this person is trustworthy, but take your call. And I expect the same thing, right? Like, I want people to recommend people or put in a reference because it goes a long way. And that's the way hiring is going anyway. Let's face it, right? It's not those days when you apply for a job, you get, you know, get a call. And gone are the days, especially with a name like me, Vrinda Shrikant or Gurasis or what have you. Like, gone are the days when, you know, you, a lot of people didn't even call me for an interview, I would say, because they couldn't pronounce my name. And believe you me, having done my master's in HR, having done a project in recruitment, this is something that used to happen a lot. It hasn't gone away yet. There's still a lot of, you know, places if you go, you don't get an interview call because the recruiter is not able to pronounce your name, or they just have a bias just looking at your name. I had, I'll just give you a quick example here. I had a friend who was doing her master's with me. She was from BC, but we were doing it from University of Regina. In this particular class, she shared how she had a Chinese name. And every time she applied, she didn't receive a call. She got married to a Caucasian. She changed her name on the resume to her Caucasian name, to Sarah. And she said, you won't believe, every job I've applied for, I got a call.
Wow.
So this is a true example that somebody shared in the class. And that was not, you know, that was 4 or 5 years ago. So it's not gone away. So a lot of things, right? This is a lot to unpack, actually, just deviating from where we started. Yes, giving back is important. Yes, putting people in, you know, in positions that they deserve when they come to this country, because this country promises a lot. Networking is key. You know, get in touch, talk to people, polish yourself. Continuous education is important. Build on what you have, you know, continue to do that. And anybody can do anything. Just stay positive. That the glass is always half full, not empty.
Absolutely.
Right?
Yeah. And you know, sometimes I think not everybody knows their way around the system. And I'm so glad there are people like you who are in those roles, who's able to make that decision. I'm so glad that there are people like you who are in that position to make that role. Because I remember you telling me that somebody else also took a chance on you. Somebody else also gave you a chance. So that's why not you give somebody else a chance as well? And especially if somebody does have the experience.
100%. Just because you did that doesn't mean other person has to go through it if they deserve it. Again, goes back to deserving.
Yeah. And I wish more and more people understand that, because then there are examples where people say that I have gone through this, you will also go through this. And I really absolutely hate those people. And the funny thing is, I have come across many of those people, and many of the listeners, you know, some of the listeners I'm in contact with, that has happened with them also. People have told them, oh, you also have to go through the same thing because I went through. Instead of collaborating together, learning from each other, your experience can actually act as a catalyst in other people's success. So 100%. Why not to do it?
Totally agree with you on that.
So with that, now before we get into the final segment of the podcast, I am going to introduce this new segment. I'm calling this Know Your Host, where I'm giving my guests an opportunity to ask me any question you want.
Love it. Oh, love it. Okay, so here goes. This is your rapid fire.
Okay.
What is the one thing that you've discovered about yourself, whether after coming to Canada or just as part of your life learning?
Okay. I would answer that by saying that I discovered a chef within me. did not know that I could cook well food. And I'm not, you know, tooting my own horn here, but I think my friends have told me, the people who have tasted my food, they've told me. Because before that, back in India, I don't think so I have ever cooked apart from Maggi or boiled few eggs, probably, maybe in worst case scenarios. But otherwise, the food is always served, just like all of us, you know, everybody who comes from their home countries, the food is served to them all the time. But when I came here, I started experimenting. Of course, you know, I have had my own mistakes where I have burnt the garlic so much and the food tasted bitter. Then I learned the correct time to put the onions in, making sure the onions are, so it's like, I think I have also evolved with that.
Perfection.
And I have learned, I think now I'm able to cook, you know, Mexican food. I have cooked, obviously, ooh, like Thai food, obviously Indian, which I absolutely love. And I think I love food a lot. That's what I have learned from myself, that I love every kind of food, and I'm not at all awesome. Hesitant to really experience anything new that come my way. I'm absolutely okay with that. And another thing I would add to that is I've also learned to try it by, and not in terms of cooking only, but in terms of anything, because growing up, I always had that fear of trying it, that thinking so much about the repercussions of things, that what will that happen? Why, what if it doesn't go the way I want it to go? Or because it was something, because I think we have grown up in a culture, I was grown up in a culture where it was more about doing things, keeping in mind the repercussions of what will people say, you know, so to say. But I think now I am really unlearning that and learning that it's absolutely okay to do whatever you want to do. Try it, experiment it. If it works out, great. If it doesn't, it was a great experience, and it, you can use that experience somewhere else. So yeah, these two things. Love I would it. Say first, definitely I think I like cooking. I find still, it therapeutic. Nice. And second, having no fear of trying, experimenting new. Yeah,
absolutely love it. Love it, love it. My second question would be...
Oh, there's another one. I thought there's only one.
Okay. Oh, is there only one? Okay.
No, please go on. I'm just kidding. Yeah.
No, I was just curious, you know, I to know a little bit about, you know, you've been here and you've made a living, yep, in the last few years, and you do these interviews. Is there one individual that you've interviewed in the last season so far? Mm-hmm. That stands out to you, that you feel like this was powerful?
It's a very hard question, because I think I say it all the time. I have learned so much from each guest of mine, each guest, and it's very hard to choose one. But if I'll tell you like a general topic, general discussions, which really, I would say, shape the way I wanted to drive my podcast, I would say that. The one was my discussion with Shola Rose. She is originally from Nigeria, and her episode was called Have Blinders Towards Hate Speech. And that gave me a very good perspective of, because she is, you know, Black origin, and how she perceived things. She said that whenever somebody asks me, you know, how are your English is so good, or any question about my color or anything that she came across, she said, it's really important to give people the benefit of the doubt rather than you taking it to your heart, because if you do, it really stops you from going to the goal that you really want to achieve. So that really stayed, wow, with me, that this is such a beautiful thing, that it's, yes, obviously it's important to gauge whether the person is coming from the point of curiosity, the person who is genuinely curious about the colors of my turban, or the person is just being racist. And you don't want to go on the racist side, because you don't want to brew negativity. It's okay. Person, yeah, said exactly, something, move on in your life. You don't have to, you know, like she said, have blinders towards those, and welcome and appreciate the question, the one who is generally curious about it, and answer it. So I think this, that episode, that conversation was really an eye-opener for me for various reasons, and really helped me shave and drive my conversations I had with the people. Yeah, I would say that.
Beautiful. I think you put it really well.
So it's my turn now. Now we are in the final segment of the podcast. I call it Beneath the Accent, because we are knowing each other beneath the accent. I've got a couple of questions. You can answer them in one word or a sentence, or however you feel like. The idea is just to know more about Vrinda. So ready?
Ready.
First, the classic question. What advice would you give to Vrinda, who is in the initial months of landing in Canada?
What advice? Stay positive.
Describe a moment when you experienced a significant cultural difference that surprised you?
Significant cultural difference. I think I'll go back to time in Weyburn. I think it's so rural that it's very hard to relate to a lot of things that people do differently. Okay. If I had to name one, it's just the, I don't know, ice fishing.
Okay. I never heard about that.
Who does ice fishing? That was a shocker to me. A lot of people do ice fishing, apparently.
Okay.
That's what it's a different, you know, feeling comfortable in the cold, the minus 45, sitting outside fishing. Yeah. I still can't relate to that. So that could be me. I appreciate it. I would enjoy doing it if someone teaches me how to do it. Don't get me wrong. But that's something that was completely, I was blown away. I was like, wow. You do that?
Okay.
Okay. good for you.
What's this one dish from your home country that always brings you comfort and nostalgia?
Chole bature.
Anytime. Okay.
Or golgappa.
Okay. What's your favorite cultural festival or celebration in Canada? And how do you usually celebrate it?
In Canada, I think Thanksgiving, if it has to be Canadian.
Yeah.
Thanksgiving, because I feel like anybody can relate to Thanksgiving. I don't think you need to be from a certain culture to be able to give thanks for what you have. And I think we don't express gratitude enough for what we have. And I think taking that moment, that day off to be with your family, to be thankful for your family, I think I would definitely, we do that year over year. We make an attempt to, you know, do what we can to say thanks and get together. And I think that would be one thing Canadian. And if it is Indian, I think Diwali is something definitely we like to enjoy. We, you know, get together with friends, play cards, do what we, you know, used to do in Delhi, I guess.
Okay. And is there something from your home country or your tradition that you managed to preserve up until today in Canada? Any object?
My mother's ring. I got that when I got married, and I still have it. I still wear it. So it's very near and dear to me. And that would be one thing that comes to my mind that I've carried.
Tell us about your first friend that you made in Canada.
First friend that I made in Canada. Oh, wow. Yes. You know what? When I first came to Saskatchewan, BC, not that many friends. But when we first came to Weyburn, Saskatchewan, my husband was, you know, he was there already for 3 months and was craving Indian food. So he took me to a real Canadian superstore there. And I didn't know where to look for these things, right? It's, they don't have a lot of Indian stuff there, but they did. So he wanted to have, I don't know, chole or something. I don't know what he wanted to have at that time. But I saw an Indian person walking in superstore. I followed them.
Okay.
I, you know, I made an attempt to introduce myself and say hello. And I started speaking, you know, and I asked them, "Aap Hindi bolte ho?" You know, I asked them, "Do you speak Hindi?" And he said, "Yes." And then, and then he got very excited because he was, they also didn't have too many people. And he said, "You know what? You should meet my wife. She works for Walmart." And it was such a small, I said, "Yeah, sure. We're going to Walmart now." So he told me her name. I went to Walmart. I asked for Rimmi. Her name is Ramandeep Kaur. They're also from Punjab. And believe me, you, we became the thick of friends. We still are friends. We went to Vegas earlier this year. We went to Vegas, my husband and I. Rimmi posted on Facebook that she's on her way. We met in Vegas after so many years. So we were in Weyburn. They moved to Vancouver. We moved to Toronto. But we have some fond memories of, you know, if you want to, if you, when that question comes to me, who's your first friend in Canada? I would say it was Rimmi and Simran. You know, they were best friends, and they continue to be very, you know, in touch.
That's an incredible story. I love that.
I know. Amazing. I do things like this.
Yeah, amazing. And have you tried maple syrup on anything surprising?
I'm not a big fan of maple syrup.
Oh,
so
okay.
I am lying. So we were in Quebec 2 weeks ago, and we had a maple syrup whiskey.
Okay. How was, did you like it?
It was not bad. It was too sweet for whiskey, but it was a different flavor. It was a smoky maple syrup flavor. So that's something different, that, you know, combination of maple syrup and whiskey. I wouldn't have even thought of it, but we had that on a cruise there in Quebec, which is pretty neat.
Okay. If you could create this one law that everybody has to follow, what would it be?
Really thoughtful questions, thought-provoking. One law that everybody should follow in Canada or generally?
In general. If you want to separate, that would be even better. But whatever you say.
I would just say stop the fight that's happening in the world right now. You know, I can introduce a law that can just have peace in the world, I think it's important. And I'm not just saying it to sound really good. It's really hurtful to see.
Yeah.
I've been following the Hamas,
I agree with you.
You know, Israel war so closely. And it's just so hurtful to hear and see people who have nothing to do with this war, but they're getting hurt. And this is just going to add to the agony of war as we move forward. You know, people who are being hurt for no reason are going to stand up and start fighting for no reason. because they were hurt. And that's kind of the history that we've been seeing. And I think if I had the ability to create a law, and that would be it, right? No fighting, like stop it. What is this? Same thing in
Absolutely.
Ukraine, and it's just been going on for almost 2 years now. What is this? It's impacting everybody across the globe. And if this is going to lead to world war, can you imagine? Like, what is the lives of our future going to look like?
Yeah,
Not
absolutely.
good. So yeah, that would be me. I know it's sad, but that just comes to my mind. And you know, following it so closely, I think all of us are impacted in some way or the other.
I mean, absolutely. I think seeing me as well, you know, coming across all those posts and stories, I think definitely I would have created the same law to please have peace. So stop.
Have peace. Yeah, stop it.
Okay. If you could swap lives with somebody for a day, who would it be and why?
Nobody. I love my life. I'm very thankful. I don't want to go become somebody else. No. I think
Okay.
I'm grateful, very humble for everything that I have. And I think, you know, gratitude is important. I'm very grateful. I'm not looking to become somebody else.
Love
No.
that. Do you have any quirky habits or rituals that you follow in your daily routine?
Oh, I don't know if you want to say that or share that. I love my coffee in the morning.
Okay.
It's non-negotiable. And that coffee, you know, I love to have it as soon as I wake up and, you know, relax watching TV first thing in the morning. News, basically.
If you could be a contestant on any reality TV show, which one would you choose?
It would be a musical show because
Okay.
I have learned Carnatic classical music for 14 years of my life. And I do believe
Okay.
that, you know, I've sung in the radio and stuff like that. So if I want to
Oh,
revive that, I would do that
wow.
for sure.
Okay. But this is also sort of like a radio platform. Can you sing something for us? I would love that.
Ooh, I'm not
Why not?
ready.
Nobody's judging. No judgment here. Safe zone.
Okay, there's no music, but okay. अजीब दास्ता है कहाँ शुरू कहाँ खत्म ये मंजिलें हैं कौन सी न वो समझ सके न हम अजीब दास्ता है कहाँ शुरू कहाँ खत्म ये मंजिलें हैं कौन सी न वो समझ सके न हम That's it.
Love that. Beautiful. Applause. Love that.
Thank you. Thank you for making me sing, Gurasi. I wasn't ready for that.
You're never ready for these conversations, so it's
I
absolutely
know. Impromptu.
So describe Canada in one word or a sentence.
Land of possibilities. Safe. I can say that for now.
If you could leave me with one piece of advice, what would it be?
You're killing it. One piece of advice. I would say, not for you per se, just generally. This is one thing I do believe in. And it is, you know, it's not the smartest person who always gets that promotion or moves forward. It's the person who's the hungriest who moves forward. And you know how I came about this after I watched your podcast. It's also very relatable to, you know, from what I shared in the beginning of my in school, not being academically inclined, being in sports and stuff. It's not always the people who are smartest, who have the best grades, who go forward, or who are really good at what they do. It's how hungry you are to get go to the next, you know, level or what have you in life, just generally in life, whether it could be career or whatever. I feel that. So that would be my piece, to be hungry to, you know, to really want to do better at what you really think you want to do in life. Be hungry for it. I think people succeed.
I love that. You know, I think a few years ago I came across this quote that says, I think it was from The Alchemist, from the book Alchemist. It says, it's not the fastest or the smartest person who wins, it's the person who thinks he can who wins. And
Wow.
I love
Yeah,
that.
this is so true. It is actually, yes. Put your mind and heart to it, you can do it.
And finally, how would you describe your experience of being on the podcast?
Oh my God, I don't have words. I think I will be selling this show short if I didn't use the proper adjectives to actually describe this hour and a half that I spent with you, Gracie. I think you It was absolutely humbling. What comes to my mind really, because you put me at that pedestal with your fantastic words to describe or open this whole season. I'm really honored. I think you bring out the best in people, if I can put it that way. Your questions are very thought-provoking. I wouldn't have thought about, people don't think about these things about themselves unless questions are asked. And that's why I say I feel very honored to be here, because this opportunity has actually made me think about things about my life, about me, that I wouldn't have otherwise thought. And same thing with your podcast, with everybody else that I've heard so far. I think you kind of indulge in a conversation which is so meaningful, not just for your show, but for the person who's actually on your show and also for your listeners. So kudos to you for doing that, taking that time out. And I think it's becoming just popular and more popular. So thank you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much for your kind words. And I am honored. And thank you for your questions that you asked. And I'm sure that listeners would be having the same questions about the host, I'm sure. But really, really, really enjoyed this conversation, Vrinda. And I'm looking forward for people to really listen to this and learn more and more from this. So thank you. Thank you so much for being on the podcast and adding value to my listeners. Thank you.
Same here. Thank you ever so much for having me. It's my pleasure, and honor. Thank you.